On building and managing security forces in India, moving blue collared to blue uniforms. And ladies and gentlemen, please help me in welcoming our panelists for this session. Ms. Rekha Gairola, Regional Security Advisor, Aviation and Aerospace Industry. Colonel Harjinder Singh, Head of Training, Raksa Security Services. Paul Debsey, Regional VP, ISIS International, and the moderator, Dr. Rajiv Mathur, Regional Advisor, Asia, OSPA.
Thank you, Aditya. Thank you for the introduction. We have my colleagues. Okay, Colonel Harjinder is there. So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. After so many power-packed panel discussion, fireside chat, where we have discussed and spoken about the security and the future of the security, we have a subject to speak, building and managing security forces in India, moving blue collar to blue uniforms. And I have my colleagues here, Colonel Harjinder from Raksha Security Services. He is from the training perspective of a guarding company, and we have Rekha Gairola, who is managing the security of a very large corporate, Boeing, and of course, Major Paul Devasi. He also represents ACES as well as the head of security at Oyo Rooms. We have just heard General Sanjay Soi talking about the CAPC annual seminar, and we had General VK Singh addressing at the inaugural session. He made three very valid and very important points about the private security. He said that security forces are going to grow. The second point, he said that security would need more and more technology. And third, he said that security would need training and upskilling. Having said so, we have realized, we have learned, and we have seen that manned guarding private security industry has regained a long due respect that it has, and the scope of security service has gone much beyond what it used to be before the pandemic. Having said so, I would like to invite, first of all, Rekha for her opening remarks and talking about how do a corporate would contribute in building and managing security forces in India. And of course, you can give examples of your offices, your organization, which is across the globe. And moving blue collared into a blue uniform, we already realize, we already understand that a security, a CSO or a security has a security head has a permanent place in the boardroom now, after what we have seen in the last 20 months. Rekha, your opening remarks, please.
Hi, Rajiv. Thank you for inviting me to talk on such an interesting topic. And hello, everyone. I'm hoping that all of you can hear me now. Ever since we have moved into pandemic and with this virtual thing, I think this is going to be my opening. You can say prayer. Hope you can hear me. All right. So, It's so unfortunate. I mean, if you ask me, Rajiv, that we are quoting pandemic, COVID, that it took COVID to let, the C-suite and the boards to realize the importance of security, right? But that's the fact. That's the truth. But I'll talk about it, and I think I have quite a few minutes, so I can just, talk about it, and then I'll try to sum it up in such a fashion that I'm able to convey what I'm trying to convey here. So when we talk about security today, Rajiv, it's not a small topic or a subject. It's a very vast subject. So and today's agenda, again, is something, if we start talking about the aspects and different parameters, believe you me, one day is not enough. So security evolution, when we talk about this evolution from the beginning, the reason, why we started talking, and I'm talking about globally here, right? From physical security, and then, requirement, and then close perimeters, and then we needed guards at that point in time. And then slowly and gradually, requirements you know, got changed. There was more in less kind of thing, you know, started seeping into corporates, and that applied to each and every function, starting from finance or let's say business, and then eventually to security as well. And if you talk about opportunities, there are a lot of opportunities there. But the question is that, are we ready to, you know, grasp the opportunity? And what opportunity I'm talking about here is that this transition, you know, from physical security and the physical aspects of security to now, you're talking about technology. I've just heard Major Manjeet Rajan talking about artificial intelligence and machine learning. So we are now talking about technology, you know, the next era and, you know, the future generation also and also forth. But I'll just talk about 2-3 points that I can cover. Otherwise, like I said, there's so many things that we can actually cover. The most important thing now, when you say, you know, from blue collar to now, you know, the whole different transition, the need of the hour, I think, is if we are really planning for that future, is to break that stereotype. We have that stereotype within the industry. And when I talk about stereotype, there is no one kind of stereotype. There are many stereotypings there. For example, and you know, this is not the exclusive list, there are many, but these are very common. You know, we find it everywhere, even the resumes, right? One is that of ex-servicemen or ex-military, right? That a security personnel should be ex-serviceman, he should be ex-military. And then, you know, the very stereotype that I just mentioned, he, right? We talk about men in security. So now we have women in security. I'm so proud to say that we have so many women who are coming forward and, you know, who have actually carved their own niche in security. But then is that all that we are looking at? No. I mean, there is more that needs to be done. We have different, you know, panels and the forums such as Women in Security. I think there's so many which are really doing amazing work. And then third one is that it is predominantly about the man-guard security or the physical security, right? Now, this is not the thing anymore. And you rightly said, COVID has changed. Now, if you ask me if COVID has changed, I won't say COVID has changed. I think COVID has just helped us to really realize that, you know, security is far more than, you know, what we normally talk about. Today, I think corporates are looking at security professionals who can really cover information security. So we call it InfoSec. They're looking for professionals, you know, who can, so investigation for most of the corporates, they, you know, sometimes add investigation into security and sometimes they add into HR, but now it's about technology, the technical investigations, right? So cybersecurity or the forensic security. And then business continuity. I mean, these are subjects which for which you really need that kind of skill set. Supply chain security. We saw the importance of supply chain during the pandemic, didn't we? And for that, you need to have certain skill set, you know, understanding of geographies, the topographies, and, you know, connection, the connectivity and the logistics. It basically covers a lot, right? And of course, our bread and butter, which is, you know, crisis and risk management. Now, what corporates are looking at, many, and if not all, I'm telling you, next 10 years, you would, and then again, I mean, I think I'm going too far. In next 5 years, you would see corporates in India, globally, it has started happening. They are going to combine all these verticals of security into one. And they are going to say, okay, fine. So this is security. And for me, it is not just physical security. You're the CSO. You need to see how are you going to build your team. And I want all the answers under one roof. So one-stop shop, right? So like I said, I mean, it's a vast subject. I can take whole day to talk about it. So like my initial question was that, are we ready with the right skill set? So I think what is important is, you know, breaking these stereotypes is so, so very important. Otherwise, you are not going to attract, train, and get right people. You know, if we start talking about, and with due respect, I'm not saying that, you know, those who are ex-military or ex-servicemen, they are not fit to be for this job. No, that's not what I'm saying. Or I'm not saying that, you know, women in security, we really need, no, I'm not saying that. I'm saying we have the base. All we need to do is that we need to, you know, just upskill ourselves. It's the time of, you know, like we're talking about technology every time, how we can actually club these two things together and really focus on what is the need of our, right? And then just, you know, sell the best package to the corporates. And like I said, there is the opportunity there. All we need to figure out, are we ready with the right skill set and right people who can actually say that, hey, look, you know what? I've done information security and I'm an ex-military man, right? Or I'm a woman professional, but you know what? My niche area is, let's say, cybersecurity or supply chain security. So like I said, to sum it up, thing is that we need to find a right balance. We just cannot say that, you know, I have done certain things and, you know, physical guarding and the basic things that I have been doing for this far is sufficient. The time is there to start upskilling ourselves, understand the need, and then just go for it. And it resize the limit thing. Yeah, back to you, Rajiv.
Thank you, Rekha. Thank you. Very wonderfully, you said that we need to break the stereotype. And you also said that we need to upskill the people who are doing the security. This is not about the man guarding. It's also about technology. And we just heard Major Manjeet Rajan saying that it's not going to be security and technology. It's going to be the technology company looking after the security going forward. So wonderful. Moving on to Major Paul Devasi, just to let you know, Rekha, that there are two ex-military people in this forum, is in this panel as well. So Major, you know, he has not written Major, so it's important for me to let everyone know that we are talking to Major Paul. Paul, what are your thoughts? You have a responsibility of managing multiple sites and most, and some of them are actually outsourced. So how do you think that manpower that you required before pandemic and now, what has changed for you, Paul?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Rajiv. So it gives me great pleasure that you have thought me worthy to be on this panel. And first of all, after listening to Manjeet, and then after that, Rekha holding forth, well, obviously it is now, I got big shoes to fill. So first of all, obviously, so, you know what, Rekha, what you said about the stereotypes is very correct. In fact, a lot of my friends from military who say that, should I join security? I said, no, don't. It is a skill and it is an aptitude. Either you have it or you develop it. Don't just think that just because you are in the army or you are doing this, you can do it. No, you cannot. I will personally not hire a lot of people whom I know just because they are from the army. They don't have that. So that is about stereotypes. So you know what? Couple of things when I was looking at this entire industry of ours, which we're working. And like Rajiv said that this entire COVID has really been a wake-up call to us. And we have, to quote, to paraphrase Rekha, we have re-realized that security is important. And at times, I also have to put my hand on my heart and say that I, being part of this industry, I am also at fault that it took a COVID for us to make us realize the importance of security. So that is, I put my hand up. So this industry of ours is employing around 8.9 million people. It's not a joke. It's a significant amount of revenue generator for a lot of people. It is supporting livelihoods, families, and everything. And conservatively, this entire market is valued around $18.2 billion US dollars. So that is something which is again significant. Like Rekha said, what she's saying is correct. Man guarding part forms around 75% to 80% of the entire private security industry. And the unfortunate part is that in spite of this having 8.9 million people and still growing, As per a couple of surveys, we found that only 10% of the entire industry were organized. The rest is still disorganized or unorganized, or a whole lot of stuff is happening. Then, so thankfully, into this mess, we had Passara, which came into being. So Passara has been a game changer. It has not changed the game, but I do see that it's becoming a catalyst for people to change. At least people have started saying that the guards must have certain amount of training. The quality of training, well, you know what, it's us as professionals have got to demand that from the vendors. If we don't demand a certain upgradation in their knowledge skills or the skill levels, we will not get that. Let's be very, very, clear on that. And the next thing is that, so all of us know in India that the security guards are deployed in a whole lot of places. But when you compare ourselves to the world, what are they also doing? So we find that in abroad, the private security agencies are involved in guarding the periphery of prisons, transportation of prisoners, then at times senior citizen protective security services, then surveillance and control rooms. So when these first three sentences are heard, typically a lot of people say, oh, you know what, we are going to deprive policemen of the jobs. So I said, no, it's not that. We are, as it is in India, policeman to public ratio is very skewed. We are in a very bad shape. So by doing that, by using the private security agents, security personnel in these places, we want to free up valuable police manpower to do actual policing on the ground. So that is the way that we are supposed to look at that. Not saying that, you know what, you're going to deprive them of their work and they have to do something else. So this is something that this can be done by the private security industry. Then another thing is that in a lot of places, especially abroad, during crisis situations, the police or the government enlists the services of the private security agencies. So that is something which has not been done. It's been done in a very, very stopgap or in a very, very, tactical way, not in a very process-oriented way. I may be wrong, but yes, this is what my feeling is. Then again, there are some areas wherein India has made advances, like, for example, managing of events and festivals, where, again, police is deployed in in huge numbers. So they can be freed up. So these are some places where we need to start thinking of. And for me, one of the biggest things about going back to stereotypes, I was reading somewhere that in the West, they don't use the term security guards anymore. They have started using the word security officers. The mere use of the term from guards to officers, the way you talk to them, who's that? I think William Shakespeare said that rose can be called by anything, but no, I don't agree to that. If you're called a security guard, you're treated differently. And if you're called a security officer, you're treated differently. But so these are some things that come to my mind. But overall, we must also remember that what is the amount of training that has been imparted to them. So I know I've had the pleasure of working with certain organizations who have insisted, and they've paid for, and they've demanded, and they've got excellent security personnel who are deployed on the ground or in the offices. And these guys were worth their weight in gold, the way they used to, their soft skills, the way they used to conduct themselves, the way they used to act during crisis events. But yes, unfortunately, to put it in a very nice way, India or Indians' risk appetite is very high. So we believe in the divine intervention and all that. So we, a lot of times, unfortunately, again, this is a failure of people like us, that people tend to look at the minimum wages security guard or the minimum wages person. So I keep telling persons that if you are going to expect that you're going to have a minimum wages security person and he's going to act like a mixture of James Bond, John Rambo, and Arnold Schwarzenegger, I mean, I think you are expecting a bit too much. So there's a whole lot of work to be done, and it's a very bright field. There's a whole lot of automation which can be done, whole lot of technological empowerment which can be done, places that has to be done. So that has to be driven by persons like us in, what should I say, in partnership with the security agency. So this is something that we have got to start. It has started happening, but we have got to start looking at the security service providers or the persons from where we are getting these security guards as a partner to us. And we're going to start treating them like a partner. And we're going to start sitting with them and start developing them and how things can be used, how the, like Manjit Rajan said, the humble CCTV can be used. What are the uses of it? Whole lot of time we just, I keep telling my friends that if I take a Ferrari's engine and fit it into a Maruti 800, apologies to Maruti Suzuki, if I fit it into a Maruti 800, will it work? No, it will not. The engine itself does not do the job. You got to have the aerodynamics, you got to have the braking power, you got to have other stuff. So it has to be the system has to be changed. The system has to be changed and upgraded. So these are some thoughts, Rajiv. Back to you.
Thank you, Paul, for a very insightful deliberation on the subject. And I think coming to Colonel Harjinder Singh, the most difficult task in front of you, Colonel Saab, is that there is a lot of expectations. The pandemic has anyways changed the scope of work of a security guard. We are already hearing about a lot of technology that he has to learn. The scope has gone beyond so many things that he does. We have people like Captain Sanjay Sharma, who is talking about the expectation that he has from a security guard. Paul just defined an expectation. We are also talking about the security guards replacing police and paramilitary roles at airports, etc., etc. So what is, from your point of view, Colonel Saab, is the future? I mean, are we actually looking moving blue collared profession to a blue uniform? Are we thinking that he would become like Paul is saying, he would become a James Bond or Schwarzenegger in the coming times? Colonel Saab.
Thanks, Rajiv, and of course, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. And of course, thanks a lot for inviting me on this panel. It's been a great learning. Whatever, I haven't been able to attend the whole session, but definitely what Rekha and Paul have brought up. Wonderful insights into what is happening in the security industry, what is happening to the, I would say, the personnel, and how and which direction they are moving in. Basically, as I see it, and I keep telling all my, I'm in this training establishment, and I tell my people, there's a very specific role, you could say, which is cut out for the private security industry. We look at the military, the Army, Air Force, Navy. They are protecting our borders. They are protecting us from the external, you could say, the external enemy, external threats. The police and the paramilitary mainly looking after the internal threats, be it the law enforcement, be it any other internal threats that come up. But the private security industry, what they are doing, they're literally and actually the third pillar of security within the country. They are protecting the economic might of the country. And this is what I tell my boys who are passing out my academy. And I tell them, look, you are no less. You are as important to the system as anybody else, be it the army, be it the police, because a lot of them have tried for the army, have tried for the police, but haven't been successful. You speak to them, they tell you, I could not compete in the run, or I couldn't come in the the numbers which were finally taken as selected. So the economic might, and that actually is the growth engine for the country. If they are providing the security, and as we've seen, they've been doing a damn good job of it. It is only because they have the firstly the role, the role which is defined to protect them, to protect the industry, and thereafter the capabilities which they have acquired, which they have been skilled with, and now on the job performing the duties. Now all that combines and giving the industry the foundation to look after the business, to take that forward and assure of themselves that okay, the security is there, they will look after. And this came out so clearly during the pandemic. So mainly it's the third pillar, as I see, for the country, for the country's security and the economic security, mainly. Now, when we look at them as from blue collar going to the blue uniforms, very very pertinent example is Rajiv was saying that we can take examples of our company. I'll take my company. We are Aksa, and we are there at the airport, Delhi Airport. Everybody has gone through Delhi Airport. We are managing the complete landside security of the airport. And today only we were building up on our website, and we were coming out with figures that how many thousands of people and thousands of vehicles are using the ramps, both at the at the departure or at the arrival, and how seamlessly they are managing it. And earlier, if you go back into time and go back when we used to have Delhi Airport only Terminal 1, which was under the Airport Authority of India. And we used to have those police guys, with those vans and those tow trucks trying to push these cars forward. Now see how the whole system has evolved. The complete thing, which was earlier done by the policemen, is now being done by private security and doing a damn good job of it. So that is where the blue collar has moved out to the blue uniforms. Okay, we have our own specific colors, but definitely as it signifies, we are doing that. It's not only at the airports, we are doing a lot of other things, be it at the traffic management. I'm sure a lot of you have been to Gurgaon, and you would have seen Cyber City being manned by the security people, security guards of whichever company is there. I can offhand say SIS has been managing a lot of security on the traffic intersections. So going forward, it is moving into blue collar. Yeah, I would go maybe a step further and say, yes, we have moved in and we are enlarging the scope. So that is a little bit on what we have done and are in the process of doing. Another thing I would like to mention here regarding the private security person in the businesses, wherever we are. When we enter, we are greeted by a guard, and the guard is he's either checking that we have the right authorization to enter, and any type of even Paul brought out and Rekha brought out, any type of crisis we come across, anything, we immediately look for the security guy to help us, be it a small fire coming up in the premises, or be it a medical emergency. We know they are the guys who have been trained to take that on. So that is another, you could say, it's become something like foundation where we always fall back on and say, yes, if the security is there, we are safe. So that is again a place where from that humble guard, where he used to just be manning a gate or something, he is now becoming a part of the system. He's becoming a part of the company to provide services which could actually mean life and death at the site. So that is a very important aspect which has come in. And another thing which we are expecting our guards to do, and our security personnel really, is when we look at them, We look at them in, and in case I can use this thing, a little loose comparison, what the country looks at the, you know, at the military, be it in case of floods, be it in case of, I mean, at the national level, a company looks at its security personnel for similar things, be it, you know, be it any small crisis happening, the security is always there. Be it a small intrusion happening, the security is there. Be it anybody, you know, there's a small workplace violence incident, the security will be there. So overall, it's the security which is, you know, filling this particular role and doing a damn good job of it. So the blue collar, blue, I think, really speaking, they, specifics for they having moved is already happened. Then another thing, we've got that. How do you manage these guys? How do you build them up? Firstly, what is the quality of personnel that we are getting into our security services, be it our security agencies? What do
Kanal Saab, I'll come back to you with that question, because I wanted to first ask the user Rekha and then Paul, like what Kanal Saab is saying, that how do we train him and take him to that level? The expectations are certainly very high. You know, we are asking him to learn technology, we are asking him to learn artificial intelligence, machine learning, etc. We are also talking about him in the skilled category now, and we are giving him the but minimum wage. What is the expectation, Rekha, you as a user in your premises from a security guard, and what is the difference between what it was about 2 years ago?
All right, so Rajiv, I mean, if you ask me, and when we talk about expectation, let me just make one thing very clear. When we talk about upskilling, not just the guard, but the whole security professional, it's not going to happen overnight. It will take, coordinated efforts by everyone. When I say everyone, I'm talking about corporates and the service providers. Now, coming back to your question, that if, we have to train a security guard who is guarding our facility, what is that we can do? I think that's where, corporates or the CSOs can actually provide, or rather collaborate with the service providers, so service providers and cooperate. So, and it has to be industry-wise. So for example, there is an industry. So security professions are all across different industries, and different industries have their own demand, right? So let's say there's an industry who's dealing with technology. They would have certain requirement, for that particular corporate or companies, certain SOPs, but you need to train. So when I say you, I'm talking and I'm referring to the corporates, right? So the corporates need to really carve out a particular module for them to understand the industry and the company and provide that training. Similar way they provide this orientation to their employees, right? Now, because this guard is working and is associated with the corporate, I think the same applies to the guard as well. So those basic trainings from the corporate side, talking about, the company's requirement and what is that they need to do. And then to service providers to kind of invest into the security guard and upskill, the guard force as per their training module. So it has to be a holistic approach. Just saying that, service provider's job to upskill and provide training, that's not going to happen. You need to collaborate with the corporate just to understand their requirement and just give the best practice.
Thank you, Rekha. Moving on to Paul, what is your take on this? What is the expectation that you have from the service providers, from the training of a guard? What has changed in the last 2 years?
Thanks, Rajiv. So if around 2 years back, somebody told me that the security guard will take the temperature of doctors, and I would have said, okay, I think you are, I think something is not right with you. But then that happened. So we just found that the security guard who may not be able to converse with you in Queen's English is taking temperatures and noting it down and being the hands and foot on the ground and the eyes on the ground and giving information back. So it's a question of, so again, it comes back to the fact that we as persons have not understood or not understood the potential of using of security guards or security personnel who are deployed on the ground. So that is something that we've got to understand very carefully. And so a lot of times we are very, lot of us are very happy in maintaining status quo. What is the next step? Where should we go ahead? That is something that a lot of us need to put our hands on our hearts and do it. So I too am again at fault because I like to keep telling that what I have not done. So that's something that I've done very infrequently. So this is something that, so one of the first things that about security guards is that security agencies, what is it that you're protecting? Like Rekha said, hers is a high technology area, so you require a certain amount of ways that you're doing this. But if you're going to have a guard from one of my previous companies, which was e-commerce, Amazon, well, the Amazon guy's mindset will not work typically in a tech-enabled, in a company, and vice versa. So so there's one term which is used in Forge, which is percolated down to the civil also. Guard post instructions. What each post, the work has to be done, that has to be elucidated and written in the most threadbare manner as possible. Because if you're going to tell a security guard, go forth and conquer, so he will do whatever he feels is right. And it is not his fault. I'm not saying that there are guards who are not doing work. There are guards. But what I'm saying is that you don't start off with the thing that by not giving him the basic ground detail, giving the platform of expectation that is there. So that is something that we as professionals have got to actually put our mind to it. And again, if we have got to understand this, and that is again our way that we must convince our people. What are we trying to achieve? Do you just want a body standing over there, or do you want a skilled person standing over there? So if you want a skilled person who understands technology, who can understand things, so he'll become a force multiplier. And so can we eliminate persons who are not so skilled? So whole lot of, so that means, again, going back to the fact that minimum wages. So minimum wage is something that is, you are heading for disaster. I shudder to think if you're going to be in a technology company or in a sensitive place and you have minimum wages guy coming over there. It's going to be difficult. So those certain things that keeps me awake at night, these are certain things that we've got to do. And picking on to what Rekha has said, that we have got to partner with the security agencies. That is very, very important. And sector-based skill training is very, very important. The soft skill that is required in a hospitality is different. The soft skills in a supply chain is different, and industrial atmosphere is different. So that has to be told. So presently, all the security agencies which are coming, there are certain agencies who are providing time and effort and trying to tell them certain things. But with all due respect to the security service providers, they are providing generic training to the persons. So that is the place where we come in. That is the place where we have to invest. If you're going to expect that the security agency will only invest, I think that's wrong. We have also got to invest by telling them, ki, bhai, mujhe, what do I need? What can I do? How can we upskill? What are the places that I require? And it's not just telling that, you know what, I want to impose a fine on you. Okay, well, that's okay. I understand that. But there has to be change in the process to see that how it's going to benefit us. So these are some thoughts that I had on this particular thing.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you. Kamal Saab, my last question to you is that how do we cope up with the sector-based training and what a customer is expecting and how much security agency should put in? And I mean, all the customers may not be like Paul and Rekha. I mean, they would want, you know, they would actually want James Bond to be standing outside them. So what is it that you are doing to cope this up with?
Yeah, thanks, Rajiv. That's a damn good question. And you know what is happening? Definitely what Paul has brought out very correctly, that the generic, and if you really go back into the skilling, you know, there is a complete skill ministry which has come up. The guards are being skilled as per the NSQF, you know, National Skill Qualification Framework. They've got something called qualification packs. They've got national occupational standards based on which their curriculum has been designed. The Sector Skill Council under the NSDC is, you know, laid out what level of training a security guard has to be undergoing. So all that is in place, is being, you know, is being done at the training centers. But that actually is, as brought out, is generic. Now, I'll take you through a small episode or anecdote regarding what happened with me. I was heading the security of a company called Muthoot Finance. I was heading their thing. We had about 3,000 odd guards under me. And obviously, it was divided into various regions. And we were having a lot of dacoities coming in, a lot of break-ins, armed intrusions happening, and it was really going above the head. We were really finding a very difficult time. We were in a very difficult time to be able to manage the situation. So what did we do? We got into a team. We went and we started. You know, we had, I think it was more than 70 odd agencies across the country where we had guards coming in from. So what did we do? We started going down to the regions, collecting all the guards together, running a full one-day workshop, right? And in that workshop, we did everything you could think of. We did role plays, we did you know, demonstrations, we asked them exactly what were they facing, how were they getting, you know, how were these guys getting through them. And with that, we got, I mean, I can only tell you, we got fantastic results. And the complete scenario changed. These guys, we were showing them videos of people, how they had penetrated the branches, had held up the branch, taken, you know, huge amounts of jewelry out of these branches. So when these people, they saw the video, they saw what they did wrong. Thereafter, a complete change took place, and where 1 year we had had maybe more than 8 attempts and break-ins, the next year we had 0. Now, that is the quality of, you know, requirement, or that is the type of requirement which we have to fulfill as the, you know, service receivers. We have to go forward, tell the service provider, this is what my requirement is. And of course, they were there. They were providing the guards to the, you know, reaching the workshops, providing them with all the wherewithal to reach, and being able to take the message forward after we had done the workshop, and then at their levels conducting further training. So, as very correctly brought out, it has to be a jointmanship. It has to be a partnership, and thereafter, we will see fantastic results, and I'm sure across all sites, wherever they be, this is the only way, because the training centers can only give generic unless there are very, very specific requirements coming from the you know, the principal employers, and they tell them, look, we want people trained on this, and then that can be done at the training centers. Yeah, Rajiv.
Thank you so much, Colonel Saab. And I think the important takeaway of this discussion is that, you know, of course, the upskilling of a security guard is required, and we are definitely moving towards from a blue collar to a blue uniform. Paul, you want to say something?
Yes. So, Rajiv, I've had the pleasure of meeting one of my earlier managers, one of the companies. So he obviously is in the US. He started his life off as a security guard, and then he became a senior director. So that is something wherein we have not been able to make headway. Because once that happens, then persons know that this is a profession which will pay well, and there's a career progression. Otherwise, you become a security guard, you become a security supervisor, and then you keep on rotating around the thing and not happen. So again, it goes back to soft skills, English speaking, and all these things. So that is something that we have not been able to pay attention to. Those are some thoughts. Rajiv, back to you.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you. So in the interest of time, I was about to wind this up, and thank you so much, Kal Harjinder Singh, Major Paul Devasi, Rekha, for your contribution, for your time, for your deliberations. The topic is very interesting, and I think we can go on and on, but thank you so much once again. Thank you.